Praise the Lord. I welcome you to the Sunday worship service today. And I pray that everything we're doing from the beginning, as the Lord has helped us to be worshiping together, everything will be a blessing in your life in Jesus' name. And I pray that today will be a special day for you, that your faith in God will be lifted up and every problem, every challenge will be put aside from your life in Jesus' name. Give me a good amen. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for this day of the Lord. We thank you because you have kept us alive. A lot of things have happened. A lot of water passing under the bridge in every nation. And yet you have kept your people alive at such a time like this. We give all the glory to you. We're asking, O Lord, as we come to your word right now, that our heart will receive everything we hear from your word in Jesus' name. Lift up our faith, lift up our confidence, and help us, Lord, to trust more in you so that both spiritually and materially and physically, you'll bless your children in Jesus' name. We thank you because we know you have answered. In Jesus' mighty name, we pray. Amen. As we have learned together from the period of searching the scriptures, today we're looking at Psalm 3, Psalm 4, Psalm 5, Psalm 6, and Psalm 7. Quite a lot of chapters, but you know the chapters are quite brief, and therefore we've gone through in a search the scripture properly. Now as we come to the message, I'm selecting some verses from those chapters. Look at chapter 3 of the Psalms, looking at verse 3. Psalm 3, verse 3. But thou, O Lord, art a shield unto me, my glory, and the lifter up of mine head. Go to the end of that psalm in verse 8, and then you'll find in verse 8, it says, salvation belongeth unto the Lord, thy blessing is upon thy people. I told you before that that's what Selah means. Pause and think about that. Meditate upon what we are hearing. Let's go to Psalm 4 now. In Psalm 4, reading from verse 3, it's talking to us about the godly. In this section, looking at verse 3, it says, but know that the Lord has set apart him that is godly unto himself. He set apart the godly for himself. The Lord will hear when I call unto him. You want to underline that if you are godly, if you are a child of God, the Lord will hear your prayer. There is no doubt about that. He will hear when you call unto him. And then he says in verse 4, it says, stand in awe and sin not, commune with your own heart upon your bed, and be still. Don't allow anything to jolt you, to destabilize you, to distract you, or to make you afraid. You can be still in the sight of the Lord. Everything will be all right. I said, in your life, in your family, everything will be all right. In your present and in your future, everything will be all right. So you can trust in the Lord and be still. Again, it says, Selah, it says, don't just rush on. Think about that. Look at verse 5. It says in verse 5, offer the sacrifices of righteousness and put your trust in the Lord. Looks like the psalmist is calling us today to put our confidence in God, to have faith in God, and to put our trust in the Lord. Let's go to the next psalm. We're looking at Psalm 5 and we're reading from verse 2. Hearken unto the voice of my cry, my King and my God, for unto thee will I pray. It's wonderful as the psalmist is telling other people in the previous psalm, he said you can call upon the Lord and he will hear your prayer. He himself now practices what he's teaching, and he practices his own exhortation, and he said, I will pray unto the Lord. And he says, God is my King and God is my God, and he will hear my cry. Look at verse 12. It says in verse 12, for thou, Lord, wilt bless the righteous, There's no doubt about that. As you give your life to the Lord, you are born again, you are a child of God. The Lord will bless the righteous. Doesn't matter what happens around you. 1,000 may fall by your side and 10,000 on the other side. The Lord will bless the righteous. Say good amen. With favor wilt thou compass him as a shield. The favor of God will surround you. The favor of God will encompass you. Look at chapter 6, and we're reading from verse 9. It says, the Lord has heard my supplication. So quick. I just prayed now in chapter 5, and I want to testify. I want to tell you, the Lord has heard my supplication. Immediately you call, the Lord is answering. Immediately you are calling upon the Lord is answering. The Lord has heard your supplication. The Lord will receive my prayer. Let's come to chapter 7. And we're reading from verses 10 and 11. My defense is of the Lord. Arrows come from this way, affliction comes from the other way, an attack may come from any direction. It says, I stand solid, I stand stable, I stand steadfast. Why? Because the Lord himself is my defense, which saveth the upright. Look at that, the upright, the godly, the righteous, the sage, the same thing. He saveth the upright in heart. And now verse 11, this is very serious. God judges the righteous, and God is angry with the wicked every day. That's why we don't walk in the path of the ungodly. We don't walk in the path of sinners. We don't walk in the path of discomfort. We don't walk in the path of the wicked, because the anger of God, the judgment of God, and the wrath of God is upon the wicked. God is angry with the wicked every day. And now in verse 17, it says in verse 17, I will praise the Lord according to his righteousness. I will praise the Lord according to his faithfulness. I will praise the Lord according to his covenant. He's a covenant keeping God. He is righteous, he's holy, and he cannot lie. Every promise he has given, every promise will be fulfilled. Because of that, I will praise the Lord according to his righteousness. I will sing praise unto the name of the Lord Most High. Those are the Psalms we're looking at today. When you put everything together, it's talking about confidence in God at all times till the end. Confidence in God at all times till the end. You can have faith in God. You must have faith in God. You must rely on God. You must have confidence in God. And that at all times, in the valley, on the mountain, when there's pandemic, when there's epidemic, and when there is no epidemic or pandemic, every time in the day and in the night, when the sun is shining, when the rain is falling, you have confidence in God at all times and till the end. And the Lord will honor your confidence and your faith, and you'll never be the same again in Jesus' name. We're dividing the message today to three parts. Number one, personal perception and trust in God. Personal perception and trust in God. What does that mean? What do you know of God? What do you perceive of God? As you have that personal perception of the Lord Almighty himself, it will help you to trust in God. Point number two, peculiar privilege and treasure of the godly. A person who is saved, a member of the family of God, a child of God, he has peculiar privilege and is a treasure unto the Lord. Peculiar privilege and treasure of the godly. Point number three, perpetual penalty and torments for the godless. Perpetual penalty and torments for the godless. Let's come back to point number one. In point number one, we're reading from the Psalms again. Look at Psalm 4 and let us read from verse 1. Please open your Bible. God bless you. Psalm 4, reading from verse 1. Hear me when I call, O God, my righteousness. As we look at this section, I want you to look at all the areas where it says, my. It's now saying, God is my righteousness. It says, thou hast enlarged me When I was in distress, when you're in distress, and when there's challenge, and when there's difficulty, all the same, the Lord will enlarge you. He will enlarge your course. Looks like this day, an enlargement has started in your life. And the enlargement that started before, that enlargement is continuing. It will enlarge you when you are in distress. Have mercy upon me and hear my prayer. Look at chapter 5 and verse 2. Psalm 5 verse 2. Hearken unto the voice of my cry. Look at the personal thing now. My King and my God. My King and my God. I belong to you and you belong to me. I'm your child. You are my father. And it says, for unto thee will I pray. In chapter 6 of the Psalms verse 9. It says, the Lord has heard my supplication. It says, I don't have any doubt, I can go out after that this service now, and I can testify, I can rejoice, I can live a life that is honoring, glorifying to God. The Lord has heard my supplication. The Lord will receive my prayer. And then he tells us in chapter 7, verse 10, it says, my defense is of God, which saveth the upright in heart. That's why we're holy, which saveth the upright in heart. That's why we make our hearts to be pure, cleansed, and purged before the Lord, because the Lord saveth the upright in heart. When I talk about the personal perception and trust in God, there are three things we're looking at. There's number one, proper perception of the titles of God. Proper perception of the titles of God. I'm going to give you an assignment. I'll call some references of the Bible. Then you will write them down. Then you will check up on your own, because this is what gives you the faith that is personal, and the ground that is personal, and the confidence that is personal. Just write this down in Psalm 18, verse 28. Psalm 18, verse 28. I'll read it to you, but write it down, because here it says, my God. Look at Psalm 18, verse 28. It says over here, as it tells us who God is, and it tells us the personal hold we have in God, and the personal interest we have in God, and the personal trust we have in God. It says, for thou, have you opened your Bible? For thou wilt light my candle. The Lord will light your candle. The Lord, my God, will enlighten my darkness. It makes it personal there. My God. Look at Psalm 18, verses 2 and 3. Psalm 18, verses 2 and 3. It says, the Lord is my rock. He has said, he is my God. Now he says, he is my rock. He is my fortress. Look at that. He is my fortress. And he is my deliverer. He is my God. He is my strength. That's a mouthful. Is your rock personal? Is your fortress personal? Is your deliverer personal? Is your God personal? Is the strength of your life, in whom I will trust, my buckler and the horn of my salvation, my high tower. You must underline that in your Bible. And anytime you're having any doubt, you go back to Psalm 18, verse 2. Look at verse 3. It says in verse 3, I will call upon the Lord, who is worthy to be praised. So shall I be saved from mine enemies. There's no enemy so strong that can overcome you. There's no enemy so powerful that can crush your life, that can stop the purpose of God for you. You know why? Because God is your deliverer, God is your rock, and God is your defense, and God is everything for you. I'm sure you know the next one now. It's in Psalm 23, verse 1. And what I want you to understand and underline is the word my. Make it personal. It's the proper perception of the titles of God. It says, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He is your shepherd, you will not want. In Psalm 27, it says in verse 1, in Psalm 27, look at this, the Lord is my light and my salvation. No wonder the psalmist always had confidence in the Lord. He said, I'm going out, I will come back in. He says, I'm facing Goliath, and I'm going to come out alive. He says, I have challenges before me, but I'm going to become stronger. Why? because he had the personal, proper perception of the titles of God. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life, and of whom shall I be afraid? When you understand, that's what we need to meditate upon these things. That's Psalm 27, verse 1, which we have read now, and it says, he is your light, he is your strength, and he is the power that upholds and undergirds your life. Look at Psalm 28, I'm reading from verse 7. In Psalm 28, verse 7, it says, the Lord is my strength. You couldn't be any clearer. Nothing could make you afraid, and nothing can shake you. The Lord is my strength, and the Lord is my shield. My heart trusted in him, and I am held. Is my shield, I'm trusting him, I am held. I will not be abandoned, you will not be abandoned. Therefore, my heart greatly rejoices, and with my song will I praise him. He is your shield. Hey, look at Psalm 30, verse 10. This is wonderful. This is wonderful, Psalm 30. And we're looking at verse 10. Open your Bible, open your Bible. In Psalm 30, verse 10, hear, O Lord, and have mercy upon me. Look at this. Lord, be thou my helper. Can you say that? Lord, be thou my helper. The Lord is your help, and the Lord is your helper. Look at this, Psalm 32, verse 7. Look at this. Thou art my hiding place. Thou art my hiding place. I want you to picture a covering, and I want you to picture a tower. I want you to picture a solid fortress. And anytime there's any storm, anytime there's any trouble, anytime there's any difficulty, you run into that and you say, thou art my hiding place. It will hide you from affliction. It will hide you from attacks. It will hide you from the enemy. It will hide you from the powers of darkness. Are you living in a village? Are you living in a community where it appears that all things are against your life? And you say, they want to destroy me. They want to destabilize my family. They want to scatter my business. They will not. Take it from God. They will not, because the Lord is your hiding place. Thou shalt preserve me from trouble. Praise the Lord. Troubles are over. And when those troubles are still there and they are raging outside, you rush and you come into your hiding place, and it will preserve you from trouble. Thou shalt compass me about with songs of deliverance. I want to sing with you, I rejoice with you. You are delivered in Jesus' name, because now he will compass you about. You turn here, a song of deliverance. You turn over here, a song of deliverance. In the night, you sing a song of deliverance. You are delivered in Jesus' name. Look at Psalm 59, verse 17. Psalm 59, verse 17. Please open your Bible. God bless you. Unto thee, O my strength, will I sing. You see what he's saying? Unto thee, O my strength. He's saying, God is many things to me. He's my God. He's my deliverer. He's my shepherd. He's my light. He is my shield. He is my helper. He is my hiding place. And he is my defense. Look at that. Unto thee, O my strength, will I sing. For God is my defense, the God of my mercy. He'll have mercy on you. Look at Psalm 62 now. Psalm 62, verse 2. He only is my rock. He only is my rock. I don't have any charm. He only is my rock. I don't have any talisman. He only is my rock. I don't have any juju, any voodoo. He is only is my rock. I don't have any power of darkness. I don't have any connection with dark powers or powers of darkness or occultism. He only is my rock and my salvation. He is my defense. I shall not be greatly moved. He is your defense. And then he tells us in Psalm 62, and I'm reading from verse 6. It says in verse 6, he only is my rock and my salvation. Again, he mentions the word only. Would you underline that in your Bible? He only. He only, when people come to introduce to you, trust in this one, take this charm, rub this one on your belly, and this one is for pregnancy, and this one is that, you say, no, 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 because he only is my rock and my salvation. He's your Savior, he's your salvation, and he is my defense. I shall not be moved. It says in verse 7, look at verse 7 there, in God is my salvation and my glory. Wonderful. The psalmist is saying, do you think you are the only one saved? I am saved too. In fact, God is my salvation and is my glory, the rock of my strength and my refuge. And is in God. My refuge is in God. That word refuge, you see the children of Israel, if anything had happened that will make the pursuer to pursue them and want to destroy their lives, they will run to the city of refuge. And the psalmist is saying, he is my refuge. Look at Psalm 71 verse 7. Psalm 71 verse 7, I am a wonder unto many. Underline that. You are a wonder unto many. Underline that, memorize that, and take that in. Every time you come in from outside and something makes you afraid and makes your heart palpitate, rush to your Bible, open Psalm 71 verse 7 and say, I am a wonder. The way I come out of trouble, I'm a wonder. And the way doors open before me, I'm a wonder. And the way enemies are defeated in your life, you are a wonder. I am a wonder unto many. But thou art my strong refuge. Thou art my strong refuge. It'll be your refuge, city of refuge. And now it says in Psalm 73, verse 26. Psalm 73. Verse 26, it says, my flesh and my heart faileth, but God is the strength of my heart. God is the strength of my heart. Did they say something is wrong with your heart? Hole in the heart? And then the heart is weak, and the heart cannot take you, cannot take the strength of your life. God will be the strength of your heart, and that heart will be healed in Jesus' name. Look at this now, the last line. It says, and my portion forever. God is my portion forever. Say that. God is my portion forever. He'll be your portion in Jesus' name. Look at Psalm 74 now, verse 12. Psalm 74, verse 12. It says, for God is my King of old. It says, since I knew the Lord, and since I came to the Lord, he has been my Lord, he has been my master, he has been my controller, he has been my director, and he is the King of my life. For God is my King of old, walking salvation in the midst of the earth. Walking salvation in the midst of the earth. Have that personal perception and trust in the Lord. Have that personal perception and say, because he is mine, he is my God. Personal perception, he is my deliverer, he is my shepherd, he is my light. Amen. He is my shield, he is my help, he is my hiding place, he is my defense, he is my salvation, he is my refuge, he is my portion, he is my King. When you think about all that every time and you carry that perception on, every time, you will never be moved, you'll never be shaken in Jesus' name. In that section about the personal perception and trust in God, look at the second part now. Personal profession of trust in God. Personal profession of trust in God. In Psalm 7 verse 1. Psalm 7 verse 1. Are you there now? Opening your Bible. Psalm 7 verse 1. O Lord my God, in thee do I put my trust. Not in chariots, not in human ingenuity, not in human wisdom, not in rich people, not in powerful people on earth. O Lord, my God, in thee do I put my trust. Save me from all them that persecute me and deliver me. He has done it already. Look at Psalm 16 verse 1. In Psalm 16 verse 1, it says, open your Bible, please. Thank you. God bless you. Preserve me, O God, for I in thee do put, for in thee do I put my trust. In thee do I put my trust. Are you sick? In thee do I put my trust. Is something happening to your job? Don't hang your head as if something has happened that, well, you know, I'm finished. No, you are not finished. You are a child of God. I'm done. No, you are not undone. Because you are a child of God, they have leveled me. They have crushed me. The enemy has gotten me. The enemy will not get you. You put your trust in the Lord. Things will come up again. New life will come up again. Whatever you have lost, you are going to regain a multiplied fold in Jesus' name. Why don't you say amen? Amen. Look at Psalm 18, and I'm reading from verse 2. Psalm 18, verse 2, it says, the Lord is my rock. Of course, he's your rock. You are born again. You are a child of God. And he's my fortress. And is my deliverer, my God, my strength, in whom I will trust. That's the word. In whom I will trust, my buckler and the horn of my salvation, my high tower. Now, because we have this personal perception and trust in God, I'm coming to number three now, is the permanent pillar of the truth of God. The truth of God is permanent. The truth of God is like a pillar. And the truth of God, in that truth you have the promises of God. You have the prophecies of the word of God. The truth of God, you can lean upon. That truth of God is a permanent pillar. That truth of God. In Psalm 99, reading from verse 7. Psalm 99, verse 7. He spake unto them in the cloudy pillar. They kept his testimonies and the ordinance that he gave them. The ordinance, that's the truth. And then it's like a pillar. Look at Psalm 25, reading from verse 5. Psalm 25, reading from verse 5. Lead me in thy truth. It will lead you in his truth. And you can rely on that. And teach me, for thou art the God of my salvation. On thee do I wait all the day. And let's come to the New Testament in 1 Timothy chapter 3, verse 15. 1 Timothy chapter 3, and we're looking at verse 15. It says, but if I tarry long, that thou mayest know how thou oughtest to behave thyself in the house of God. Look at this. Which is the church of the living God, the pillar and the ground of truth. The pillar and ground of truth. The pillar and ground of truth. The Lord himself has revealed the truth unto us. And the truth is not shifting here and there. That truth is permanent like a pillar. And that truth will continue to sustain your life in Jesus' name. I was waiting for you. Amen. God bless you. We'll come to point number two now. In point number two, peculiar privilege and treasure of the godly. The peculiar privilege and treasure of the godly. Look at Psalm 4. We're reading from verse 3. In Psalm 4 it says in verse 3, but know that the Lord has set apart him that is godly for himself. The Lord will hear when I call unto him. I told you to underline that. Did you underline that at that time? If you have not underlined that, the Lord will hear when you call unto him. But understand, the Lord has set apart him that is godly for himself. Look at verse 4. In verse 4 it says, stand in awe and sin not. Stand in awe and sin not. You know, you're a child of God. You are so delighted with the Lord. You are so taken with the Lord. Your communion with the Lord and your relationship with the Lord, the interest you have in the Lord, are so that taking your time, taking, you know, all your attention. You have nothing to do with sin. You stand in awe, in amazement of the goodness of God, and you sin not. Commune with your own heart upon your bed and be still. Look at verse 5. In verse 5 it says, offer the sacrifices of righteousness and put your trust in the Lord. Verse 3 talks about a particular possession of God. the particular possession of God. Verse 4 talks about the peculiar purity of the godly. And then verse 5 talks about the personal priority of the godly. Let's look at 3:6 underneath this peculiar privilege and treasure of the godly. Number 1, a particular possession of God. A particular possession of God. Number 2, the peculiar purity of the godly. The peculiar purity of the godly. Number 3, the personal priority of the godly. Let's come back to number 1. That's in Psalm 4 verse 3. In Psalm 4 verse 3, but know that the Lord has set apart him that is godly for himself. You see, sometimes our children, if they belong to a rich family, they belong to a powerful family, they belong to a family that, like, for example, a politician who is number 1 or number 2 in the state or in the country. And these are children, they say, this is who I belong to. Anything happening, they don't think like, somebody who is an orphan, somebody who doesn't have any help. And the same thing with you. You are a child of God. He has saved you and he has brought you into the kingdom. And you are the godly one, you are the righteous one. The blood of Jesus has cleansed you. And now you are the godly one the Lord is thinking about. And the Lord has set you apart for himself. And so the Lord will hear when you call on him. Do you see that you are the possession of God? Do you see that you are the saint of God? Do you see that you are peculiar in the sight of God? Look at Isaiah chapter 43, verse 21. Isaiah chapter 43, and we're reading from verse 21. It's telling us, these people have I formed for myself. If you are a child of God, you are counted among these people. If you are born again, you are counted among these people. These people have I formed. These people have I transformed. These people have I created. These people have I recreated. These people have I saved for myself. They shall show forth my praise. You belong to God and you understand that every time. Look at John chapter 17, reading from verse 9. Thank you. You are opening your Bible and you are concentrating and you are marking these important verses in your Bible until they are registered in your heart. In John chapter 17, verse 9, I pray for them. The Lord is praying for you. Say, the Lord is praying for me. And God will answer the prayer of Jesus for you in Jesus' name. It says, I pray for them. I pray not for the world, but for them which thou hast given me. For them, those who are saved, those who are born again, those who are cleansed by the blood of the Lamb, for them which thou hast given me, for they are thine. Understand? He has set apart him that is godly unto himself, for they are thine. Look at verse 10. It says in verse 10, all mine are thine. You belong to Christ, all mine are thine. You also belong to God. He is your Father. He is your creator. He is your redeemer. All mine are thine, and thine are mine, and I am glorified in them. Whatever will not glorify God in your life will not remain in your life. Whatever will not glorify God in your family will not stand. Everything will be uprooted out of your family in Jesus' name. I am glorified in them. As you look at Psalm 4, let's come back to verse 4. Psalm 4 now, verse 4, we're talking about the peculiar purity of the godly. The child of God is peculiar in that he has the grace, he has the strength, and is able to abide by the word of the Lord. Look at this in chapter 4 of the Psalms, verse 4. Stand in awe, stand in amazement, and sin not. Commune with your own heart upon your bed and be still. You understand what that means? Do you ever think of who you are in Christ? And bought with a price. Think about that. Discuss with yourself. Consult with yourself. Go over again all that God has called you. The name he calls you, that's the name to bear. The work he gives you to do, that's the work to do. And the direction is leading you, that's the direction to commune with your own heart. I'm born again, commune with your heart. I'm a child of God, commune with your own heart. I am a child of God, and I'm cleansed, and there's no condemnation for them that are in the spirit and not in the flesh. I'm a co-heir, a joint heir with the Lord Jesus Christ. Think about all that, and then you say, I have nothing to do with the sin business. I stand in amazement of what God has done for me. And because of that, I sin not, and I am still. I am still. That means I'm patient. That means I'm peaceful. That means I'm not jolted. I am still. Look at Titus chapter 2 and verse 14. Titus chapter 2 verse 14, who gave himself for us, who gave himself for us. Can you think of how great Christ is, the very Son of God, and he gave himself for you, that he might redeem us from all iniquity. You know, the Lord is able, the Lord is capable, and because he's able, you just lean on him entirely. And it is not by struggling I'm trying, it's not by struggling I'm endeavoring, no, but you totally rely on him, because he wants to redeem you from all iniquity and purify, look at this, unto himself. And purify unto himself, and purify unto himself a peculiar people, zealous of good works. You are now peculiar. In evangelism, you are peculiar. In hospitality, you are peculiar. In love, you are peculiar. In helping other people, you are peculiar. In helping to carry their burden, helping to carry their load, you are peculiar. Because now we're peculiar people and we're zealous of good works. Look at Matthew chapter 5, reading from verse 8. Matthew chapter 5, and we're reading from verse 8. It says, blessed are the pure in heart. You remember? Stand in awe and sin not. Commune with your own heart upon your bed, and be still. The Lord purifies our hearts. It saves us, number one. This is subsequent Christian experience. It sanctifies us. It purifies us. And it purges us. And it says, blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. They'll see God on the final day. But they will also see God even at this present time. At this present time, when you pray, you'll see God. And when you have any challenge, you're looking for God, you're searching for God, you shall search for me with all your heart, and you shall go and pray, and I will answer you, because I have a good expectation for you. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. And we come to this familiar passage of scripture, Hebrews chapter 12 verse 14. When last did you remember this one? When temptation comes, remember this. And when trials come, remember this. When it appears you are being jolted and distracted and you cannot be still, remember this. In Hebrews chapter 12 verse 14, follow peace with all men and holiness, without which no man shall see the Lord. Thank God we're on a journey, we're on a pilgrimage, and at the end of the journey of the pilgrimage, you will see the Lord in Jesus' name. I said you will see the Lord in Jesus' name. Therefore, take all the help that God can render. Take all the grace that God has given, and take all the promises that God has given, and understand you can follow peace with all men and holiness, without which no man shall see the Lord. In our peculiar privilege as treasures of God, like the godly, we have a particular possession of God. We belong to God. Know this, that God has reserved unto himself him that is godly. We also have the peculiar purity of the godly. Now, the personal priority of the godly. The personal priority of the godly. What's the priority? Look at Psalm 4, and we're reading from verse 5. Psalm 4, verse 5, offer the sacrifices of righteousness and put your trust in the Lord. Offer the sacrifices of righteousness. What's that saying? You cannot offer the sacrifices upon righteousness. What that means is this: you cannot be a thief, a robber. You cannot be a person that is cheating other people, and then out of that which you have stolen, you come to offer that unto the Lord. That's not acceptable in the sight of the Lord. If you are doing a work that makes other people defiled, other people licentious, other people going the way of unrighteousness, and you are getting your money from a trade or from fraud that is unrighteous, you cannot say, I want to offer, I'm paying tithes and offering, I'm giving this, I'm giving that. That's not acceptable. Offer the sacrifices of righteousness. Work in a clean way and work in a righteous way and be an upright man and be a righteous man, and whatever you earn out of that way, out of that work of righteousness, now you offer the sacrifices of righteousness, and then you put your trust in God. You know what that means? When you offer the sacrifice, when you give something to God, give and it shall be given unto you. Those who are stingy, those who don't give, they don't trust in God, they don't believe that God will fulfill His promise and multiply whatever they have given, those who don't pay their tithes and offering, they don't trust in God. They say, if I give that, look at my need, look at the need of my family, and if I give all that, what will I live on? Offer the sacrifices of righteousness and put your trust in God. He will pay you back. He will reward you in Jesus' name. Now the sacrifice. When we say something is sacrifice, it means that there is something costly you are offering to God. Like Mary broke the alabaster box of ointment and poured it upon Jesus Christ, and somebody was calculating, this might have been sold for 300 pence, and then we can give that to the poor. And Jesus said, leave her alone. She's doing that costly sin, and she's offering a sacrifice of righteousness because it trusts in me. I will die for the sin of the whole earth, and then on the third day I will rise again, and I will see you again and see her again. Look at 2 Samuel chapter 24. 2 Samuel chapter 24. And we're reading from verse 24. 2 Samuel chapter 24. Reading from verse 24. This verse is so important. I'm sure you're opening your Bible to see this. And the king said unto Arauna, nay, but I will surely buy it of thee at a price. Neither will I offer, look at this, neither will I offer burnt offerings unto the Lord my God of that which does cost me nothing. Of that which does cost me nothing. Then it says, So David bought the threshold, the threshing floor, and the oxen for 50 shekels of silver. You see, it says, I'm going to offer something unto the Lord. There are people that have good gifts, but because of the sacrifices involved, they cannot offer that unto the Lord. They want to offer something cheap, something that doesn't cost them anything. Somebody has a good voice and he can sing very well, but he's thinking of, yes, my voice is good, even without the training, with before training, the voice is good, but if I join the choir, it's going to take time. And they're thinking of the cost of time it will take them. Other people have some skills and they can do that very well, and they're doing it in the world for building whatever they are building in the world, and they say, I know I can help in the church, I can help in the work of God, but if I do that, it will cost me something. Of course it will cost you something. That is the priority of the godly, that you know that I have this gift, I have this talent, I have these resources, and I'm going to offer that to the Lord, and it costs something. If you're going to teach, if you're going to preach, if you're going to evangelize, if you're going to counsel, if you're going to be a pastor, if you're going to be a missionary, it will cost you and your family something. And that is the sacrifice the Lord is expecting you offer. The sacrifices of the righteous and the sacrifices of righteousness unto God, and you put your trust in the Lord. the Lord will reward you. I said the Lord will reward you. In Malachi chapter 3, reading from verse 3, in Malachi chapter 3, and we're reading from verse 3, it says, and he shall sit as a refiner and purifier of silver, and he shall purify the sons of Levi and purge them as gold and silver, that they may offer unto the Lord an offering in righteousness. We need sanctification. We need purging. We need purification. It purifies our heart. It deals with the Adamic nature. It deals with the nature of selfishness and the nature of self-centeredness. And it takes that Adamic nature away after that purging, after that purifying. And we have the purity of heart. Now we can come to the Lord and offer unto the Lord an offering in righteousness. And while we're making that offering, we remain righteous. After we have made the offering, we remain righteous, because you know, offering without righteousness will not make us acceptable in the sight of the Lord. Offering without holiness, offering without purity of heart, will not pave the way of heaven for us. But he makes us righteous first. He purifies us first. He sanctifies us. And now we can offer the sacrifices of righteousness and put our trust in God. When the Lord will come, he will take us away in Jesus' name. In 1 Peter chapter 2, and we're reading from verse 5. 1 Peter chapter 2, we're looking at verse 5. He also, he's talking about you. We've heard about Moses, but you also. We've heard about Peter, but you also. We've heard about Paul, that offered sacrifices of righteousness. But you also, as lively stones, are built up a spiritual house and holy priesthood. And holy priesthood, to offer up spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God by Jesus Christ. You abide in Christ. That's how your sacrifice will be acceptable by Jesus Christ. You remain in Christ. Abide in him. And let his word abide in you. For without him, you can do nothing. Without him, anything you offer outside Christ, without salvation in Christ, will not be acceptable. But you offer spiritual sacrifices unto God, and it's acceptable to God by Jesus Christ. We're coming back now to the Psalms, and we're coming to point number 3. In point number 3, the perpetual penalty and the torments for the godless, for the ungodly. We're coming to Psalm 7, and reading from verse 11. It says in Psalm 7, verse 11, God judges the righteous, and God is angry with the wicked every day. God is angry with the wicked every day. That latter part of verse 11, God is angry with the wicked every day, except that wicked person will come. And then he bows the knee before the Lord, and he repents before the Lord, and he says, Lord, I've been wicked, I've been unrighteous, I've been a sinner, I have been ungodly, I've been a scoffer, but now I come to you in repentance, and Lord, I abhor myself in dust and ashes. I forget about my title, I forget about my wealth, I forget about my riches, I forget about all the pranks I've been playing. I know I'm a sinner, I depend on Christ, and I want you, Lord, to have mercy on me and forgive me and cleanse me and change my life, and from now I will continue to serve you. The Lord will not regard him as a wicked man anymore, because he has repented. He has turned away from his wickedness. But the man, the woman, the one that remains in wickedness permanently, perpetually, God is angry with the wicked every day. There's some people that think that their title will compensate for their wickedness. They think, well, I'm a king. They think I'm a leader. They think I'm high up there. They think I'm a ruler. And because of that, whatever I do, I will go scot-free. Maybe that's what Solomon was thinking, that because he was a king, he could do whatever, and even if he became wicked, if he became sinful, if he became a backslider, if he became an apostate, his title will defend him. You see, God is angry with the wicked every day. Let's look at this, God's anger at the sinner every day. God's anger at the sinner every day. Look at 1 Kings chapter 11. We're reading about Solomon now. His title could not wave off the anger of the Lord against him. In 1 Kings chapter 11, reading from verse 4. For it came to pass, when Solomon was old, that his wives in the plural, that was against the will of God, the Lord had commanded that the kings of Israel should not have more than one wife. They should not multiply wives. But he multiplied wives, it says. His wives turned away his heart after other gods, and his heart was not perfect with the Lord his God, as was the heart of David his father. What are the descriptions of the things he did? Look at verse 5. In verse 5 it says, for Solomon went after Ashtoreth, the goddess of the Zidonians, and after Milcom, the abomination of the Ammonites. In verse 6 it says, and Solomon did evil in the sight of the Lord. Solomon, that God loved, Solomon, that God revealed himself to, it says there, Solomon now did evil in the sight of the Lord and went not fully after the Lord as did David his father. Then in verse 7 we're told, then did Solomon build an high place for Chemosh, the abomination of Moab, in the hill that is before Jerusalem, and for Molech, and the abomination of the children of Ammon. Look at verse 8. This is terrible. So, and likewise did he, Solomon, for all his strange wives. You know how many of them? Many of them, hundreds of them, which burnt incense and sacrificed unto other gods. What's the conclusion? Just what we expect. Just what the psalmist has said in chapter 11 of 1 Kings, verse 9. And the Lord was angry with Solomon. Don't you think that your title will make the anger of God to go away without repentance, without restitution, without righteousness? The Lord was angry with Solomon. Don't you think your wisdom, human wisdom, will shield you from the anger of God? If you go into sin and you live in sin and you rejoice in sin, you are religious but you are sinful, you are whatever and you are sinful. God, the Lord was angry with Solomon because his heart was turned from the Lord God of Israel, which had appeared unto him twice. The Lord was angry with Solomon. Look at Numbers chapter 22. Numbers chapter 22. I was reading from verse 22. Here's another man now. This is Balaam. Balaam had heard from God, and the Lord had said, don't go. Don't do that. Don't associate with Balak, because you cannot curse the children of Israel. But eventually, when he told those people, you can go, I cannot go, the Lord has restrained me from going. And Balak sent another team. And then he said, okay, wait, I will ask the Lord again. And the Lord knew that the man was covetous, and he wanted the money by all means. And so the Lord said, you want to go? Okay, you can go. And that's what some people depend on. God gave me the permissive will. I know he said first, don't do it. But now he has said, I can go ahead and do it. And he went. And God's anger was kindled because he went. And the angel of the Lord stood in the way for an adversary against him. Now he was riding upon his ass, and his two servants were seen. Underline those last words, and his two servants were seen. And his two servants were seen. What a tragedy. When you are a servant, when you are a follower of somebody that God is angry at. God was angry with Balaam. And these servants were still loyal. They were still faithful. They were still following. And even though God revealed the angel unto the earth, he said nothing about those servants. Don't be a servant of people. Don't be a follower of people that God is angry at. How often is God angry with the wicked? He says, but God is angry with the wicked every day. Number one, God's anger at the sinner every day. Let's look at the conclusion for that. In number two, great agony of the sinner in everlasting damnation. Because of that anger, there is great agony, there is great torment for the sinner if he dies in that sin. We're looking at Luke chapter 16 and verse 24. Luke chapter 16, reading from verse 24. And he cried and said, Father Abraham, the man was religious, Father Abraham, the man knew the name of Abraham, and he claimed to be a child of Abraham, but he was wicked. He was unrighteous. His sins were not forgiven. He didn't make a covenant with the Lord through the sacrifice ordained by the Lord, and was now in eternity, and is facing torment, and is facing damnation, and is saying, Father Abraham, have mercy on me and send Lazarus that he may dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue, for I am tormented in this flame. That's the consequence of the anger of the Lord. That's the result of the anger of the Lord. It says, cool my tongue in this flame. Look at verse 25. In verse 25, but Abraham said, Son, remember, anybody can call you son, but if you're wicked, anybody can call you brother, but if you're wicked, anybody can call you my sister, but if you're wicked, you will still have the recompense of the wicked, the judgment of the wicked. They are calling us son or daughter or brother or sister will not change anything, but repentance will change everything. And believing in Christ as a Lord and Savior will change everything. Becoming new creatures in Christ will change everything. Abraham said, Son, remember that thou in thy lifetime receives thy good things, material wealth, material possession, material property that you receive, and likewise Lazarus, evil things. But now he is comforted, and thou art tormented. That's the great agony of the sinner who dies in sin and now is facing eternal, everlasting damnation. And look at verse 26. In verse 26, it says, and beside all this, between us and you, there's a great gulf fixed, so that they which will pass from hence to you cannot. Even if Lazarus wanted to pass over to you and be merciful and be loving and be affectionate and be compassionate, and even if Lazarus were to leave this place and go and give you that drop of water you are asking for, he cannot, because there's a great gulf fixed, and is fixed for all eternity, so that they which will pass from hence to you cannot, neither can they pass to us, that rich man, neither can you pass to us over here, any other person there. There's no repentance beyond the grave. And anybody on that side cannot say, now I repent. Now understand, when I was on earth, I didn't believe in God. I said God did not exist, but now I know God exists. I repent now. There is no second chance in the grave, and there's no repentance in the grave. Those who are over there cannot pass to us that will come from this. There's agony, great agony, serious agony on that other side. I pray you will not be there. I didn't hear your amen. I said you'll not be there in Jesus' name. Look at Revelation chapter 14. And we're reading from verse 10. Revelation chapter 14. We're reading from verse 10. It says in verse 10, the same shall drink of the wine of the wrath of God. Who are those? The people that God is angry at. The people who die under God's anger. The people who come to judgment and their sins have not been forgiven. The people who were not righteous before they got to the grave. It says the same shall drink of the wine of the wrath of God, which is poured out without mixture into the cup of his indignation. And he shall be tormented, that same person, the unrighteous, that same person, the ungodly, that same person, the sinner, shall be tormented with fire and brimstone in the presence of the presence of the holy angels and in the presence of the Lamb. How long will that be? Everlasting damnation. Look at verse 11. In verse 11 it says, and the smoke of their torment, the smoke of their torment, the smoke of their agony, the smoke of their suffering, the smoke of their punishment ascendeth up forever and ever. And they have no rest day nor night who worship the beast and his image and whosoever receiveth the mark of his name. I pray that will not be your Lord. Say amen. I said that will not be your Lord in Jesus' name. But you know, if that is not going to be your Lord, your name must enter into the book of life. How does that happen? You turn away from sin. You turn to the Lord, you hold on and you trust in the Lord Jesus Christ, your Savior and your Lord, and you abide in Him until the end of your life. Revelation chapter 20, reading from verse 10. Revelation chapter 20, reading from verse 10. And the devil that deceived them was cast into the lake of fire and brimstone, where the beast and the false prophet are, and shall be tormented day and night forever and ever. The devil, the beast, the false prophet, the antichrist will all be in that lake of fire. And they'll be tormented. Satan will be tormented. His angels will be tormented. The demons will be tormented. And the antichrist will be tormented. And the false prophets will be tormented day and night forever and ever. Look at verse 15 of that same Revelation chapter 20. And whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. I pray that will not be your Lord. If that will not be your Lord, what's going to be your Lord? For those who come to the right hand side, for those who become righteous, those who become new creatures in Christ, the glorious acceptance of sins into everlasting eternal delights. Glorious acceptance of sins into eternal delights. Look at Psalm 16, reading from verse 11. Psalm 16, reading from verse 11. Thou wilt show me the path of life. Thou wilt show me the path of life. In thy presence is fullness of joy. When you get over there, paradise. When you get over there, heaven. When you get over there, the eternal habitation of the righteous. When you get over there, in the presence of the Lord is the fullness of joy. At thy right hand are pleasures. There are pleasures forevermore, forevermore, forevermore. I pray you'll be there in Jesus' name. But you know what it takes? We're coming to Psalm 24, and we're reading from verse 3. Psalm 24 verse 3, who shall ascend into the hill of the Lord, or who shall stand in his holy place? Those who have the intention, and those who have the desire, and those who have the expectation that on that final day they will be in the heaven, they will be in the paradise of God, in the holy hill of the Lord, and will abide there forevermore. They will avoid the torments and the agony of the sinner, the agony of the people that God is angry at forever and ever. And they'll come to the right hand side, they'll come to the land of good and great delight. Who shall ascend to that hill of the Lord? Who shall stand in that holy place? Look at verse 4. It says in verse 4, he that has clean hands, he that has clean hands. When you come to the Lord and you confess your sin, when you come to the Lord and you are cleansed with the blood of the Lamb, when you come to the Lord and your sins are forgiven, and if there's anything you have stolen, anything you have taken, you give them to the owners. If you have taken a woman, a lady, without seeing the parents, you give her over again to the parents. You clean up your life and everything is all right, and you have a renewal in your heart, regeneration in your heart, and you have a clean life outwardly. He that has clean hands, that's salvation, and a pure heart, that's sanctification, and a holy heart, that's sanctification. He that is pure in heart, that shall see God. It says, number one, salvation, number two, sanctification, and a pure heart, who has not lifted up his soul unto vanity, nor sworn deceitfully. Those are the people you'll see the Lord on that final day, and I pray for you that you'll see the Lord on the final day in Jesus' name. Did I hear your amen? Sins forgiven, sins taken away, and the chain of sin broken, and you're set free from all the shackles of sin, and now you live a righteous life, and your hands are not sticky anymore, stealing, having unclean hands anymore. Clean hands remain, pure heart remains. You see the Lord on that final day in Jesus' name. It tells us in Psalm 61, reading from verse 7. Psalm 61, verse 7, it says, he shall abide before God forever. I want to claim that. I want to stand on that promise of God. I want you to claim that. And I want you to so live. And I want you to so trust in God that you will abide before God forever. Oh, prepare mercy and truth which may preserve him. Mercy and truth. You're merciful and you're truthful. You're merciful to people. You're kind to people. You're hospitable to people. You have the mind of Christ. And Christ, as Christ is compassionate, so you are compassionate. And you have that mercy all the time. If somebody offends you, you forgive. If anything happens that, you know, somebody wants to get angry and he wants to do something, you say, no, I can't do that. I will be merciful. Blessed are the merciful, for they will receive the mercy of God. And you remain in the truth of the Lord, earnestly contending for the faith was delivered unto the saints. You abide in the Lord, you'll be with him forever and ever. You'll be in the Lord forever and ever. And the grace of God will keep you until that day. The strength and the love of God will keep you until that day that you will abide, you remain unto the end in Jesus' name. Look at 1 John chapter 2. 1 John chapter 2, and we're reading from verse 17. 1 John chapter 2, we're reading from verse 17. It says, the world passeth away, and the laws thereof. The things that appear interesting, exciting in the world, those sinful things, those fleshly things, those lustful things, all those things are passing away. Look at this. But he that doeth the will of God shall abide forever and ever. Who is that person? I pray that will be you, me, us, in Jesus' name. We doing the will of God. The will of God is to repent. We doing the will of God. The will of God is to be saved. We doing the will of God. The will of God is to be sanctified. We doing the will of God. The will of God is to be obedient to the word of the Lord. And it says, he that doeth the will of God will abide forever. And I pray that will be you, and you'll abide forever in Jesus' name. The grace of God abide with you. The love of God abide with you. The goodness of God abides with you. And all that Calvary has provided, the resources of Christ from Calvary abide with you forever in Jesus' name. Say amen. We thank the Lord for what the Lord has revealed unto us about our confidence in God. And I pray that your confidence and your trust in God will not be misplaced at all times, until the very end. You'll have confidence in God. Why don't you arise up now and don't think about any other, don't do any other thing now. Come to the Lord now all over again. As a child of God, come to the family. As a servant of God, come into the family. family and say, Lord, here am I. I have confidence in God, and all the time I'm going to maintain that confidence in you. All through my life, I'll not backslide. I'll not be like Balaam. I'll not be like Solomon. I'll not be like the one that was trusting in you and then goes back again. Confidence in God. At all times in the family, at all times, there is no fighting, there is no evil sin. They're telling us that, you know, during this lockdown, that family violence is on the increase, you know, fighting is on the increase, but you have confidence in God at all times, lockdown or open up, whatever. You are having your confidence in the Lord until the very end of your life. You continue in love, you continue in understanding, and you continue in mercy, you continue in the grace of God, and you continue in the faith, in confidence in God, trusting the Lord all the days of your life in Jesus' name. Your personal perception of the titles of God. Personal perception of the titles of God. Are you born again? Then you understand He is my God. Are you born again? Then you understand He is my deliverer. Are you born again? Then you understand He is my shepherd. The Lord is your shepherd. You will not lack. The Lord is your shepherd. You will not want. The Lord is your shepherd, and everything, every good thing belongs to you. Have that confidence in the Lord. Have that perception in the Lord. My God, my deliverer, my shepherd, my light, my shield, it will shield you. And any attack, affliction, anything, arrow coming, the Lord is your shield. And the Lord is your helper. He'll help you. He'll help you. You'll regain what you have lost. He'll help you. Your health, you'll regain. He'll help you. And your finances, he'll come back again. He'll help you. He is your hiding place. Have confidence in Him. And when evil eyes try to look at you, they will not see you, because God Christ is your hiding place. He is your defense. He will defend you. And He is your salvation. You are saved and you are protected and preserved. He is your city of refuge. And He is your portion forever. And He will be your King. He will be your Lord. Have that proper perception of the titles of the Lord. And have the proper personal profession of trust in God. I will trust you. I will trust Him. I will trust Him. Anything happening, I will trust Him. Are you sick? I will trust Him. Are you perplexed by anything at all? Any situation at all? I will trust Him. Put your trust in God. He will not fail you. He will not disappoint you. Everything good will come your way in Jesus' name. And then you stand, you lean upon the pillar of truth. Lean upon the pillar of truth, because that truth is permanent. Heaven and earth, the sky, the firmament may pass away, but the word of God will never pass away. Lean on those promises that cannot fail, and lean on the prophecies that cannot fail. It's a permanent pillar of truth for the godly. And now you understand, you are peculiar in the sight of the Lord. You are a treasure unto the Lord, and you are the property of the Lord. You are a peculiar, particular possession of God. He has created you. He has reformed you. He has purified you. He has refined you for Himself. Think about that. You are not for Satan. You are not for secret society. You are not for occultic gang. You are not for evil society. You are for the Lord. He has created you. He has recreated you. He has reformed you. He has transformed you for Himself. And now you have that peculiar purity, because He purifies you. And He says, stand in awe and sin not. Always think about that. Sin not. And the Lord will keep you from sinning in Jesus' name. What's your priority? You offer the sacrifices of righteousness unto God. What you earn righteously, what you earn legitimately, what you earn uprightly from the work of your hand, not from stealing,
not from robbery, not what you earn out of selling your body to do evil, to mess up your life, but out of what you do legitimately, you offer unto the Lord sacrifices of righteousness. And then you can trust in the Lord, and the Lord will answer your prayer. And it must be a sacrifice that causes you something, that costs you something. It is not something cheap. I can easily offer that to the Lord. I don't need that. That's redundant. And because it's cheap, I can offer it to the Lord. No, the sacrifices that cost you something, that you are saying, I could make use of that myself, but because God is precious to me, and because God is great in my sight, and because I give myself to honor the Lord and to serve the Lord sacrificially, therefore I offer this unto the Lord, sacrifices of righteousness. What you do in the house of God, make it a sacrifice. What you give to other people, make it a sacrifice. What you offer in obedience to the Lord calling you, that you offer something to Him, make it a sacrifice. Your tithes and offering, make it a sacrifice. And it is that that is acceptable in the sight of the Lord. And then always remember, there is an end to everything. There is a destiny, both of the righteous and of the unrighteous. And pray that your end will not be the end of a sinner. Pray that your destiny will not be the destiny of a sinner. You see, the sinner, God is angry with the sinner, with the wicked every day. God is angry with the righteous every day. God is angry with the backslider every day. When you turn away from God and you turn to Satan, and you turn back to sin, and you turn back to defilement, of course, you know, God will not be happy with that. No parent will be happy that any of their children go to give themselves to destroyers in the world. The same thing, God is not happy that anyone, any child of God, any servant of God will backslide and go to give himself over to Satan, over to sin. And so God is angry with the wicked, with the sinner, with the ungodly every day. And you want to tell the Lord anything that makes you angry, anything that makes you unhappy, oh Lord, I give up. And I ask that the blood of Jesus, the blood of the Lamb, will cleanse me, will wash me, will purge me. And all those things that make you unhappy, make you angry, everything will be cleansed away from my life, so that I will not come to the agony, to the suffering, to the punishment, to the torment of the people who get into everlasting damnation. But as your hands are cleansed, as your heart is purified, as you are washed and cleansed, purged and purified in the blood of the Lamb, the spotless blood of the Lamb, then you have a glorious acceptance on the final day. Tell the Lord, oh Lord, that's what I'm expecting, a glorious acceptance of the saints, of the godly, of the righteous, of the sage, of the man of God, of the woman of God, of a child of God on the final day, so that I will enter and be accepted into eternal, everlasting delights. And in the presence of God, the eternal presence of God is joy forevermore, delights forevermore, peace forevermore, and bliss forevermore. Pray that the Lord will count you worthy, that will escape the damnation of the righteous, the damnation of the wicked, and you be for the Lord and be in the Lord all through your life, abiding in Christ, abiding in righteousness, abiding in grace. And then when you leave this world, straight to heaven you go. And so will you ever be with the Lord. Amen. Amen. God bless you. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you today. We bless your name. Thank you because you are calling us to confidence in you. Our confidence is in you. We cannot have confidence in any other. And we know because of what you have done for us, our sins forgiven, the Spirit of God given unto us, that makes us to cry, Abba, Father, that brings us to have titles and ownership of the titles of the children of God. Lord, we thank you because we are born again. We thank you because our sins are forgiven. We thank you because new life has come to us. And Jesus said, I go to my God and your God. I go to my Father and your Father. And he says, if your Father's on earth, even though being evil, are able to give you good things, how much more will your Father who is in heaven give good things to them that ask him? On the basis of what Christ has done for us, on the basis of our connection with the Lord, our conversion by the Lord, on the basis of our regeneration, we now say God is our God. God is our light. God is our shepherd. And God is our rock. And God is our defense. And God is our shield. And God is our defender. And God is our defense. And God is our refuge. And God is our portion. And God is our king forever and ever. Lord, we know because we belong to you and because we abide in you, you will shield us, you will defend us, you will be a refuge unto us, you will be the strong tower, and the righteous runneth into that strong tower and is saved. We pray, Lord, our lives will be secured and saved even before you in Jesus' name. We thank you, Lord, because you have given us that trust and confidence, and we can say we trust you. We can say we believe in you. We can say we rely on you. We have the confidence that as we trust you, any prayer we pray according to your word, according to your will, you'll answer us, answer your people in Jesus' name. And we pray, Lord, the pillar of truth will not shift away from our confidence, that, Lord, will stand on that pillar, will lean on that pillar, and will not be shifting from this to this and going from truth to error. Will stand and abide with the truth of your word all the days of our lives in Jesus' name. We're asking, Lord, as you have reminded us that we belong to you and we are your particular, peculiar possession. Oh, Lord, we pray that will be with us every time and that will remain in us every time, that we know that since we're born again and since we're your child and your children and since we totally belong to you, we're set apart unto you. We're reformed unto you. We're recommissioned unto you. And we're refashioned, remodeled, and recreated unto you. And Lord, we pray, we'll always see ourselves belonging to you, devoted to you every time in Jesus' name. And we're asking you, Lord, that peculiar purity that ought to be in the life of a child of God, that will be in our heart, cleansed and purged and sanctified and made holy, will be totally purified in your sight, pure in your sight, in Jesus' name. And we're asking, oh Lord, that all the offering that we ought to offer will make that a priority. We'll not give you the tail end of our spending after we're spent on every other thing. And then we'll remember, oh, I need to give something. And then we'll bring something that is not even up to a tithe, not qualified to be tithes and offering. Lord, this will be our peculiarity and this will be our priority, that we're offering unto you. We're seeking the kingdom of God first and his righteousness, and then we're sure all the other things we need in life will be added unto us in Jesus' name. And Lord, you have reminded us once again, we knew this before, that you are never happy with sinner, you are never happy with the sinner, you are never happy with the wicked, and you say God is angry with the wicked every day. Lord, we pray that in our lives, every moment, every day, and at every crossroad, we'll avoid anything, everything that will make you angry at us in Jesus' name. we will remain in your love, in your pleasure, and we will end our life in your love, in your pleasure. And so when the trumpet will sound, we will not go to the left-hand side and have the agony of the sinner forever in damnation, but we'll go to the right-hand side and have eternal delight, eternal joy, eternal blessing, eternal bliss, eternal blessedness in Jesus' name. And we're praying that that glorious, delight will be ours forever. We pray, Lord, while we're here on earth, all the strength we need, all the power we need, all the support we need, all the defense we need, you grant to everyone. And you have said you will answer our prayer. For every child of God, every brother, every sister, every boy, every girl, as we belong to you, everything we open our mouth to claim from you, you will answer in Jesus' name. And we pray that this confidence we have will continue. This confidence will abide forever and ever. At all times, we have confidence in you. Till the very end, we'll keep on having confidence in you. Let your hand be upon all your children. Let your hand be upon all your people and your blessings upon everyone. And this new week, Lord, it will be a week of joy, a week of happiness, and a week of receiving from you, a week of blessedness, and a week of supplying all the needs of your people in Jesus' name. Confirm it, O Lord, in every life. We thank you because we know you have answered. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. God bless you. You are blessed already. Have a wonderful week.